Paul says, we ask you, brothers, to respect those who labor among you and who are over you in the Lord and admonish you, to esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, brothers, admonish the idle, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with them all. See that no one repays evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit, do not despise prophecies, but test everything, hold fast to what is good, abstain from every form of evil. This is the inherent, infallible, and all sufficient word of God. I pray that we will continue to allow God and to do all that we can to work this into our lives so that we understand our relationship with the shepherd and the great shepherd and our responsibility. Kind of looking at this passage in four different headings. One we looked at last week is the responsibility of the shepherd to the sheep. And then we're going to take a look now at the sheep's responsibility to the shepherd, the spiritual condition of the sheep, and then depending on how much time we have, the sheep's responsibility to the great shepherd. So we're going to, in this second item, we're going to back up a little bit and hit the beginning of verse 12, and then we'll continue on with verse 13, 14, and 15. Last week, we discussed that nothing is more devastating to the spiritual progress of a church than an unwholesome relationship between the sheep and the shepherd. And that goes also without saying with our relationship or the sheep's relationship with the great shepherd. The shepherd must fulfill his responsibilities, and the sheep must fulfill their responsibilities to the shepherd. And some have said this is where the health of the church resides, in this relationship, and understanding it and living it out. I want to just quickly take a look at verse 12. And then we'll move on and consider the rest of our text this morning. In verse 12, it says, now we ask you, brothers, to respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you. We mentioned last week that this sentence is structured as a request. We ask you, we request of you, brothers. A request to continue to do better, and even to urge them on. A general calling to live obediently to the instructions that have been given by the apostles here, the apostle here in this text, in the name of the Lord. We mentioned last week that the sheep are to respect and appreciate the shepherd. This word respect literally means to know or to identify, to take note of, as well as to esteem. So we are to acknowledge and respect those who minister among us. Remember, it's our responsibility to know our pastor well enough to have an appreciation for him and to respect him because of the value that he brings. We discussed that the work of the pastor is summarized kind of in three areas. And in verse 12 again, he says, now we ask you, brothers, to respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you. The church is to take note of those who work hard, those who are over us, and those who admonish us. They're also to, they have a responsibility to exercise authority. Those who are over you. This literally has an idea of those who stand before you. In general, it doesn't depict an office as much as it does a task. The one who stands before you in Paul's letter is both a leader and a caregiver. They lead and direct. This is a delegated authority by Christ. This phrase, in the Lord, This is not from men. They are to exercise authority over us in the Lord. They are called and equipped by God and here in this congregation on authority from God, given to the church by God. Then they also have a responsibility to provide instruction. Remember, this instruction that we looked at last week is in view of correction, with a view of changing us, the sheep. And nothing could be easier, right? What an easy task to do, to be responsible for leading sheep and to changing them. The good news is that we have the Spirit dwelling in all those who believe, who aid in this. The shepherd is to teach with an element of warning and correction, directing us toward holy living. He is to give warnings of sin and danger and to reprove and rebuke faithfully, sometimes with sharpness and sometimes with tenderness. So the work of the shepherd is to work among us, to have authority over us, and to lead us in the path that God has designed for us. This second point we'll look at today is the sheep's responsibility to the shepherd. And again, we're going to pick up just a little bit of the beginning of verse 12 and then concentrate on verse 13. So in verse 12, it says, "Now we ask you, brothers, to respect those who work hard among you, who are over you in the Lord, and who admonish you, and to esteem them highly loved because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves." The actions of the church are described in three ways that we'll look at. We are to respect or appreciate our master, esteem him very highly in love, and to live peaceably. The people must appreciate and know their pastor, as the sheep should know his flock, so the flock should know their shepherd. They must know his person, hear his voice, acknowledge him as their pastor. The sheep must pay due regard to his teaching, ruling, and admonitions. The respect the church pays those who minister in the Lord is not to be some type of a half-hearted respect. To appreciate them very highly or with highest regard is the impact of this. We are commanded to appreciate our pastor to the greatest degree possible. And again, the good news of the gospel is that when we fail in this command, we can repent to God and we can repent to our pastor and begin following these commands. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can fulfill these commands. God has ordained leadership of the local church. The head of the church, Christ, has given gifts to people, and according to Ephesians chapter 4, given people, among them pastors, to the church to exercise his will. The flock needs a shepherd, and God has provided his sheep, his congregation, with a leader. To accomplish this, to accomplish his will for his sheep. The church is not a dictatorship commanded by the pastor, nor is it a democracy led by the congregation. In the book of Ephesians alone, we're reminded in chapter 1, verse 22, that he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, speaking of Christ. In chapter 4, verse 15, rather speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, unto Christ. And also in chapter 5 and verse 23, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body and himself. The church, I think, is best described, and I had some conversations with the pastor about this throughout this week. I think the church is best described as a Christocracy. Christ alone is the head of the church. He alone has purchased the souls of its true members, and he alone has the right to command its destiny. Verse 13, he says, and to esteem them very highly in love. Those who are over you translates two words, meaning to stand before, one who stands before you. Pastors have charge over us in the Lord. They stand before us to lead and to direct. They are to be in charge. They have delegated authority by Christ, providing spiritual wisdom, guidance, protection, and direction from Christ. The phrase in the Lord indicates their calling is not for men. They are called and equipped by God with authority from God. And this oversight is a great responsibility. Think just for a moment, if you will, of the responsibility to answer for the souls of those who pastor. As brothers, the leaders are among us, and as leaders, they are over us in the Lord. This could be a strained relationship. Apart from true Christian love, it will be a strained relationship. For a pastor to be among and over at the same time demands grace and the power of the Spirit in his life as well as ours. And if this gets out of balance, his ministry will be weakened and possibly even destroyed. Some church members want their pastor to be their buddy, but this weakens his authority. On the other hand, if he emphasizes only his authority, he could become a selfish dictator. We don't see either one of those in the scriptures. The church is also to esteem or to respect her leaders in love. This is one thing to follow someone out of respect or out of tradition, but it is quite another thing to follow someone in love. To follow in love speaks of a binding relationship and for us to place ourselves under his authority. The church must esteem their ministers highly in love. They should greatly value the office of the ministry, honor and love the persons of the ministry. Show their esteem and affection in all proper ways, and this for their work's sake, because their business is to promote the honor of Christ and the welfare and the souls of men. And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. That is, on both account of their labors and especially on account of the dignity of the office. For their work is the work of the Lord. Both love for their person and respect for their authority are commanded here. As we consider this thought of the pastor and their work, I want us to consider one other question. It just kind of kept rolling through my mind as I continued to read this. Who does the pastor report to? Some congregations may think that the pastor reports to them. They called him, they voted him in. Some may think that the pastor reports to God or to Christ. Either way, even if we look at the former argument of that he is here to do what the congregation says he needs to do, who does the congregation seek out to determine whether the pastor needs to be here or not? Typically, it's God. So when we think about this idea of who does the pastor report to, Scripture is clear that God has ordained leadership for the local church. Knowing that a congregation boasts to call pastor, we look to God for guidance. The head of the church has given the gift of a pastor to the congregation to accomplish the will of God. To accomplish was the will of God for that congregation? And this is easy for us to sit here and answer the question, right? Who does the pastor report to? Well, he reports to God. What happens if something, let's say the pastor does something that I don't particularly agree with, or he didn't meet my expectations? Then who do we act like the pastor reports to? It's really easy for us to kind of think it's ourselves. So whenever you and I have an issue with our pastor, what should we do? And I kind of assume this is going to be whenever, not if ever, right? I don't care who you are, you're never going to fulfill anyone else's expectations completely. Sometimes you may not even know what those expectations are. How in the world could you ever fulfill that expectation if it's not even spoken? And if it is spoken, is that what's supposed to be happening for here, for this congregation? So whenever things come up, as they will, we're all human. The thing that sets the body of Christ at large apart from the world is the ministry of reconciliation. Us going to a brother or a sister and asking for forgiveness because we've sinned against them. And then demonstrating the power of the gospel and being willing to forgive. That's what sets this all apart. For us to love others as we love ourselves, and for us to love others as Christ has demonstrated his love for us, literally dying on the cross. So we are to have a responsibility to appreciate the shepherd, to esteem the shepherd. And then there's this phrase here, be at peace among yourselves. Live in peace with each other. This is somewhat independent from what precedes and what follows. It almost kind of seems like this was stuck in as an afterthought. But yet here it is in the middle of this text that we're considering. Paul may have intended this command to stand out by being a brief but simple admonition, to make a pointed statement. A comparable command occurs in the writings of several New Testament authors, including Mark and Paul in Romans and in 2 Corinthians, and then also the writer of Hebrews. A call for peace among believers of the God of peace is not surprising. How different would churches in America look if we would heed this command? Simply, be at peace among yourselves. Every group of people is going to go through times when we're not at, I'm going to go through times when I'm not at peace with myself. How can I possibly be at peace with anyone else? And if I'm not at peace with God, I don't have a hope of being at peace with anyone. Different would this church be if we followed this command wholeheartedly, abandonedly, radically, fully committed? I cannot but think how different the world might view the church if we lived by this command to simply be at peace. One commentator states that in connection with that immediately, it precedes this thought, which must mean, stop your complaining. To live at peace may mean as simple as stop complaining. I mean, because you know when we complain, who are we complaining against? The providence of God that placed us there? Or maybe that it was just some accident that we ended up in a circumstance, or crossways, or something that I didn't particularly like, or wouldn't have chosen. Instead of continually criticizing the leader, this passage tells us we need to follow their direction. And what might the result be? peace with one another results from obeying these instructions that we've been given prior, to appreciate our pastor, to esteem him very highly in love. Peaceful conditions existed in the Thessalonian church, but they had to continue and guard the peace and unity. So even if a church is experiencing a time of peacefulness, number one, we have to continue to work on that diligently. And then secondly, we've got to guard that with all diligence. Much dissension in modern churches is traceable to church members disobeying these commands. Again, much dissension in modern churches is traceable to church members disobeying these commands. The next thing that we see in this passage in verses 14 and 15 deal with the spiritual conditions of the sheep. In verse 14 it says, "We urge you, brothers, warn those who are idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to each other and to everyone else." Again, we see this exhortation as a brother. "We urge you, brothers." Throughout the letter, that brethren refers to the entire church. And the word idle here is an interesting word. It literally means unruly or disorderly. It was originally a military term expressing the character of the soldiers who would not keep their ranks. A little bit different mind picture than timid. It would seem that disorder existed among the Thessalonians and that several of them neglected the common duties of life and they had abstained from working. However, this displays itself in a congregation, we are to not be disorderly. We're to live by these commands that we've just looked at. The second condition, spiritual condition of the sheep, encourage the faint-hearted. Comfort the faint-hearted or desponding. Those who are perhaps agitated about the fate of their deceased friends, or who are despaired of the grace of God, perhaps by reason of their sin. These are not to be reprimanded, but comforted and exhorted. We also see here the spiritual condition of dealing with weak sheep. Help the weak. This is an idea of giving support to the weak. The weak are not those who are physically weak or sick, but who are spiritually weak, whose faith may be feeble, who are afraid of persecution, who are troubled with vain words. These are to be supported, established in faith. The disorderly have to be admonished, the faint-hearted have to be comforted, and the weak are to be supported. These are the spiritual conditions that we see of the sheep. And one of them, he puts in this next phrase, "Be patient toward all men." So we've, in working through this text, we've seen somewhat of an out of ordinary command to be peaceful, and now we're seeing one that tells us we need to be patient. Certainly no problem for any human being, right? Especially if you're in an airport, like I was last week. No problems at all. same representative 10 times to try to talk to someone on the phone and get out of that tree that you're in. These are powerful things that we could just look at and just walk right through and almost ignore. Live in peace with each other and be patient toward all men. All men in general, whether believers or unbelievers, patience and forbearance are being exercised. This exhortation encourages the church to be patient with everyone. A patient person is one who is not quickly or easily provoked to emotional outbursts or hasty actions. Paul did not identify any particular group toward whom the Thessalonians should be patient. It's all men. It's very possible that Paul was encouraging patience due to those who were offensive or annoying. In general, anyone not like me. Because I'm lovable all of the time. But other people, there's where the problem is. He may have had in mind the disorderly that we just talked about that were in the church. The unruly, the weak. But whoever the offender is, Christians should have the same godly patience in dealing with troublesome or troubled persons as God has demonstrated in his dealings with sinful humanity, specifically you and me. That's our model. That's our call. To live at peace and to be patient toward all men. In addition to dealing with people who were hurting, the church sometimes had to deal with people who had hurt others. And we see that here in this next verse, in verse 15. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always try to be kind to one another and to everyone else. Vengeance, resentfulness, bitterness is a natural reaction to one who has suffered an offense. But those are not the way of the person who follows Christ. Verse 14 appears to focus on the church's response to those who are hurting, and verse 15 on its reaction to those who hurt others. The behavior commanded here is directed toward others. Believers should see that no one pays back evil for evil. Paul's advice echoes the teachings of Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 and later in his letter to the church at Rome. Paul also discouraged giving evil for evil in those passages. In Romans chapter 12, for example, in verse 17, we see, pay no one evil for evil, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all men. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. As is true in the scripture, what we think may be right, or what we think may be normal, is completely turned on its head, upside down, and we are to do the exact opposite. Instead of repaying evil for evil, or getting back, in this passage to the church in Rome, live peaceably with all men. He connects this with living to the contrary of, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. They should do what is noble and enhances the reputation of the church. They should shame the evil by returning good in return. Paul encouraged the Thessalonians to pursue the good always for each other and for everyone as well. So in these short verses, we've seen the responsibility that the shepherd has to the sheep,